In the name of God, Creator, Redeemer, Strengthening Guide. Amen. Please be seated. In this morning's gospel, we meet Jesus at the end of a very long day. He began this day traveling alone by boat to this deserted place. He recently had left his hometown where he had been met with resistance and misunderstanding and indifference. He's also heard that John the Baptist, who was in prison, has been executed, beheaded by Herod. Hearing this news of John's death, Jesus withdrew. We don't know exactly why he withdrew, but we do know that a pattern is being established where after a significant event or maybe his engagement with a large crowd, Jesus goes off by himself to regroup, to re-nourish, to have a moment alone so that he can go back out again. We don't know exactly why, again, that he did this on this day, but perhaps it was to discern what and how he should proceed with his ministry and his life call. Like his journey into the wilderness for 40 days and 40 nights, for instance, at the beginning of his ministry, where he sought to deepen his relationship with God and perhaps listen to that small, affirming voice within to help ground, guide, and strengthen him for his ministry that lies ahead. On this particular day, when he left and he goes off to be by himself, the crowds had heard where he was going, and they were there when he arrived to the other shore. And he looked up, and the disciples were there too. This quiet moment didn't last long for him. Now, you or I might have looked out and seen this, and with a deep sigh, oh, there goes my downtime. What am I going to do? But Jesus, however, saw the crowd, saw his disciples, and had compassion for them. As the day went on, the disciples noticed that they were miles from anywhere and that there was scant food to be found. And what happened next was miraculous. At first, there was not enough food, only 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. The disciples knew this, saw this, and then through Jesus, food appeared. Through blessing, through breaking, through giving, through sharing. Somehow, the people were fed, over 5,000 of them. The disciples themselves helped distribute it, and there was even some left over. Now it's the end of this momentous and powerful day. And here Jesus directs the disciples to get into the boat to go to the other side of the lake, maybe in order to give them a chance to regroup, rest, and maybe ground themselves again in their relationship with God and maybe even their relationship with him. And Jesus dismissed the crowds too, because this particular work on this particular day is done. And finally, he is alone. Now, after they are all gone, once again he goes up to the mountain to pray. Our Lord is not being selfish here. As the Reverend Herbert O'Driscoll suggests in a reflection on this passage, he seeks a rhythm of engagement and detachment in his life, a time to conserve energy in order to give it more richly at another time. And what is true for him is also true for us. With the demands of our lives and our work, it is often difficult for us to find that balance. Perhaps seeking such balance has brought you here to this wonderful area of Maine, to this locale slightly up the ridge in Blue Hill on this peninsula, and brought you here this morning. Whether or not you're longtime residents and members here, or visiting here for a month or two, or a few weeks, or just today, perhaps you are enjoying a moment of getting away, to rest, to reconnect, perhaps even to discern what might be next for you, for your families, or for your communities. As poet and teacher and scholar and visitor here many years ago to St. Francis, John Philip Newell suggests at the beginning of a devotional, he wrote, "Be still and aware of God's presence within and all around. Be still and aware of God's presence within and all around." Maybe we need 5 minutes or 10 minutes or 20 minutes just to do that, to let go of all of that that is circling in our hearts and our minds and all around us, and to know that God is present within us and without us, that we have gifts and abilities ourselves to spread that awareness and that grace of God, and that that grace of God also permeates through those around us, and maybe even through things around us, the environment, the air, the sky, the sea. It's good to get away, whether we've done it physically or we just do it in our home or at church, just to sit for a second and be aware of that presence of God within and all around. Getting away is what the great prophet Elijah has done in our first reading. Actually, he hasn't just gotten away, but has fled. I won't give the whole backstory here, but he has recently gone up against the prophets of Baal, including the king and queen of Israel. It's a potent mixture of politics and religion for sure, and our reading indicates that it will continue to be so. That's what he is called to do. Now, we can save that discussion of politics and religion for another time. Here, Elijah has made a journey back to Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai. And for him, it is sort of a reverse exodus. He questions his call and his career, so to speak, and seems lost, unsure of what to do next. He's also fearful for his own life. But the Spirit of God, the Word of God, has led him and brought him to this remote place where Moses received the law and encountered God, where the covenant with the people was established. And sitting quietly there, he hears the wind. He experiences an earthquake, sees the fire, all of these traditional manifestations of the presence of God. But God wasn't in these traditional and well-known and accepted outward signs. God was present in the sheer silence, a deeply inner awareness that encompassed and held Elijah, one that he knew in the depths of his soul and his heart. The King James Version of the Bible translates that sheer silence as the still small voice. I think we've all heard that, the still small voice within. Recognizing God's presence and hearing that still small voice, Elijah wraps his face to further listen to and encounter God. Tradition also says, like with Moses, that no one can see the face of God and live. So he wraps himself and goes out to the cave and hears God speaking to him. Arising out of that sheer silence, that inner awareness, God provides the direction Elijah needs. His next steps aren't necessarily easy. They're going to be filled with conflict and challenge. But he knows once again an affirmation of his call, and he is grounded in the work that he needs to do. Elijah is sent forth. We each have had those moments in our lives where we feel that we are in the midst of a storm, metaphorically or literally, an earthquake, some type of minor or major crisis, maybe unsure of what we can do or what comes next. We look for a helping hand, perhaps it's even in a moment of desperation. Sometimes, too, there is no time for discernment or to sit quietly because the danger is imminent. It's right upon us. And tragically, sadly, we can think of the residents and visitors in Lahaina, Maui, this past week. While the tragedy of that fire, that swift-moving fire, is great and absolutely horrific, we also know how the townspeople and others have responded to each other with helping hands reaching out to, well, just provide whatever comfort in this as the full realization continues to unfold. Peter and the disciples are faced with a scary situation this morning. They are in a boat, as you know, often a metaphor for the church. They have just been part of that wondrous event of feeding the 5,000 people with seemingly little resources. And that was a good moment for them, and I'm sure it was exhausting for them. And now, together in their boat at Jesus' direction, a strong adverse wind kicks up, and they are terrified. Jesus, deep in prayer on that mountain, in his quiet, unique way, mysterious but giving, hears Peter's cry. And he comes to him, and he comes to the boat. It's miraculous as well. They're still terrified. They don't know who it is. And Jesus just simply says, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Reassured, and at Jesus' command, Peter walks on the water towards Jesus. Now, we know that at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, Peter is given the name Rock. And we know the strength of rocks, and we also know their incredible buoyancy, too. Rocks sink. I can assure you that if I were to walk down to Blue Hill Bay and step off a dock there, I'm not walking along the top, I'm going to the bottom. Maybe not to the bottom, but I'm just not shimmering on top there. And I imagine that's the true. I don't want to speak for anybody else, but that maybe you have that exceptional power. I know that I am still subject to fears and anxieties, that I don't hear as I ought to, or as I see things as I ought to, as I don't respond to things as I ought to. But our Lord can help me, and I think help us in these straits, in these situations. Again, our Lord reaches out and catches Peter. And I know I need that hand from time to time too. And I also know that those in the boat were needed too, to help Peter back in, and together help guide that boat to work together to bring good news to the other shore. And when they were united and coming together under that grace and that power of Jesus, that adverse wind diminished. It ceased. It didn't go away at first. They still had to deal with it, but it eventually diminished and it brought them to where they needed to go. So as we discern those things within us that we need discerning, as we reconnect and nourish, as we deal with the challenges and, yes, the joys around us, Paul has a simple direction for us. It comes from the depth of scriptures, from Deuteronomy, and it is to be received and given time again. Have faith, he paraphrases, but the specific words are, "The word is near you, on your lips, and in your heart." Here is an invitation to God's healing, guiding power, and it is one that is open to all. One commentary makes note that just as Israel was reassured that the covenant was not remote and far away, so Paul insists that Christ is to be sought neither in heavens or in Hades. It is not as if we must go in search of Christ to find him. His presence is not spatial, but is existential. It is here, part of us. It reminds me of the prayer, the well-known prayer from St. Patrick, and to paraphrase here, Christ be with me, Christ be in me, Christ beside me, Christ to win me, Christ to comfort and restore me. We are called as a church, we are called as individuals to be mindful of those gifts within us, that gift of our very being and the gift of grace freely given to us. May our lives reflect the good news of these gifts, and may we listen to and listen for that still small voice within our hearts and within our community, that presence of God in and around us, that we might discern what is right and good and know what our next steps are, and that we might be agents of that saving, helping grace to others, that others may find that peace that we know is given to us. In Christ's name, amen. Amen.